I'm talking to you today about data lakes. Before I come into data lakes, a quick motivation. Why do we actually want to have a data lake? So in companies and also in research institutions, you often have these small teams which operate independent of each other, and particularly in research with very specific equipment. And if you don't have then a global governance for the data and the processes that you work with, you can very quickly end up with those isolated data silos which are inoperable with each other. So you cannot run an analysis easily which takes input from different of those data silos. This problem is a long-standing problem, and it was first solved with a data warehouse back in the 1980s, very prominently from IBM back then. And the idea here is that you predefine a fixed schema at the beginning, for example, a star schema, as we can see here. And then you have an ETL process running, which extracts the data from the different data sources, which can also be those data silos that we just saw, transforms the data here in the staging area, and then loads the transformed data into this data warehouse. Yeah, so into this predefined schema. And there are a few disadvantages with this approach. So you can imagine if your transformation step here involve some data aggregation. So for instance, if you perform an averaging operation across multiple data points from one or also multiple data sources here, you will lose your original information and only store your average value in this table here. And this disadvantage was the reason for James Dixon in 2010 to propose something that he called a data lake. And the idea here, opposed to this data warehouse solution, is that data is stored in its native format. So you take your raw data, and without running through this ETL process to match it to this fixed schema that you define upon read, you keep your data raw in a flat hierarchical storage. And only when you read the data, you will infer this schema. And this, of course, maximizes then the reusability of your data and helps you to take the most advantage of it. And this is what James Dixon then called the data lake. If we start with this idea and just think about what this would look like on a conceptual level, of course, we need to have different data sources, yeah? Raw data sources, data silos, which already exist, and of course, much more. And you need to have a highly flexible ingestion interface, which really can accept all the different kinds of different data that come in. This data, of course, needs to be stored somewhere. So you need to have a highly scalable storage system where you can put all your data objects, your files that you upload in this storage. And if you now think you are storing, you are just throwing, dumping hundreds of millions, billions of different data objects of files in one flat hierarchical storage space, you can be sure that you will never find again what you are looking for. And to prevent such a data swarm, it's very important that each date which ends up in the storage needs to be indexed in a central data catalog. And since in the end, probably some domain researchers will work with this data lake, this indexing should also include a lot of semantic information, yeah, so domain specific information which really describe the data that you have stored in your data lake in a language which is, yeah, native to the researcher. And with this, you already have now a basic raw data repository. But this is, of course, not enough to just store data. We also want to process it. And we just now need to include some basic processing capabilities. We do it with our local HPC system at GWDG, and then we can do those workflows. So concatenated singular processing steps. And in each of those steps, usually some data artifact is created, which we then can also store back into this storage here in our data lake. Just now storing these artifacts back, of course, is again not very helpful, because we also need to get these artifacts which we store here again in our data catalog. And if we very cautiously control this processing environment, we know basically exactly what has happened, and thus we can, while storing our artifacts back in our storage system, we can record the data lineage. So how was this artifact created, by which input date, by which transformation, and then we can index everything in our central data catalog. Of course, you can think of that this indexing here is done in a database. We have a scalable storage system, and then, for instance, here some cloud computing capabilities, or as in our case, an HPC system. And now it's very important that you have a unified, homogeneous governance applied to all of these data sets that you have across all of these different systems. Yeah, if you are working with sensitive data, it's completely useless if you encrypted here at rest in your storage system, then you transfer to the HPC system, which is again a shared system, and you have it there unencrypted. Yeah, that's a data breach. And in the end, you also should probably include a nice user interface, and all of these different components together then build up your data lake. The typical workflow for a user to work on such a data lake would be that some data is generated. So I'm working together with colleagues from our medical school, from the university, and there we are working with MR scanners. So our data that is generated are MR images, and we upload these into our central data lake. And here upon the ingestion, the metadata is extracted and is indexed accordingly into this data catalog. And these metadata that has been extracted can then be used to do some data exploration, so that we can look, okay, what is actually in there? What can we use for our analysis now? And then we can just start the processing. Artifacts, as mentioned, will be re-ingested, and in the end, you usually want to have some sort of publication. So it's very nice if you can just select and package everything that somehow was involved in creating this final product. So just to sum this introduction up here, what is a data lake? What are the functionalities? Of course, we want to have this data repository, but we also want to include data analytics capabilities here, that we can do something with our data. And for this, it's very convenient to have the possibility to start remote compute jobs. And since we are working in a research institution, we want to adhere to the good scientific practice and automatically record the provenance or the data lineage. How was something created? And also want to manage the metadata of projects, experiments, tasks, and all of these things. Very important is also the possibility that we want to share with this data lake our data and the developed methods, and to foster collaborations across these independent teams. We want to enforce global governance, as mentioned, and particularly for rather unexperienced users. We want to have rather guided workflows, which can be predefined web UIs, where you can just click a little bit around, or Python notebooks, which usually also works very well. If you now look into the literature, Data Lake, how to build one, you will probably very quickly see that a lot of these papers will focus on something which is called the zone architecture. I have gotten this image from a paper from Corinna Giebler, and she has draw here 5 different examples from literature, and you see they look all very different. But the difference actually is only in the user groups that they are supposed to serve, and therefore have different numbers and different foci of these zones. The fundamental idea, however, is the same across all of these very different zone architectures. So data is always contained in these different zones according to the degree of processing they were subjected to. And also by Corinna Giebler, there was this very nice work of defining a reference model for the zone architecture. And you can see this example down here, so that you have for each of these zones, you have then a dedicated system with a different or slightly different software stack. So in your raw zone, you have an HDFS system where you record your metadata, where you have this data catalog in a CSV file. And then in the harmonized and distilled zone, a data vault is used, which is modeled in Impala. And in the end, you go over to a flat table. You also see here that she already says there is a use case independent part and a use case dependent part. And if we now look again with our perspective from our research institutions on it, there are a few drawbacks with this Ansatz. Of course, first of all, you have different systems, which is always not so nice, different software stacks for users. This is always a certain hurdle. It's not really consistency safe, right? So it's not guaranteed that something that is in the delivery zone really was a product of something from the raw zone. It's not possible for users to build up a complete pipeline from scratch. And the problem is with this design, you don't have this guaranteed data lineage, right? So maybe there is some software involved which will record this for you, but by design it's not in there. And if you have no fundamental way to record the data lineage, reproducibility is a completely different story. And last but not least, it's really hard to scale the access rights across these different systems, right? Because you have a lot of access control lists in these different software and systems, which you have to maintain to keep consistent. Yeah, it's not consistency safe, and this is very hard. And this can be maybe well done, but you always have the danger of having something like a patchwork of different software and systems, which is also not very nice. If we look rather to the industry, so AWS has its own data lake service, Lake Formations, and of course they advertise a lot of features, which in the end mostly goes back to the open source capabilities they borrowed. But what I think they manage really, really well is this unified governance across these different services. Yeah, so they have, and this is basically all really that Lake Formation is here. You have a singular unified place where you define, manage, and also can audit your access control for all the users, and they are then enforced across all the different services that AWS says is compatible with Lake Formation. So in this case, if you have a data scientist who has not full access for all the data which is stored in your S3 bucket here, he or she will make the request to SageMaker, which is then sent this query to Athena, and then Lake Formation is asked for an access token, and then with this access token, the user can only access really the data and the parts. If you have a structured table, for instance, in the CSV file, only the rows and columns which are specified for this particular user can be accessed, which is very nice, I think. However, if you want to have such a feature, I think you don't need to go to Amazon. You can do all of this on-premise. And also taking into account these drawbacks of the zone architecture, which went a little bit away from this first idea of a data lake, of having this one flat system where you just dump everything into. We developed a new data lake architecture, which we based on FAIR Digital Objects. And here really the idea is you build your FAIR Digital Objects from the data you collected and you just throw it in there. A FAIR Digital Object is shown here. So at the core, this is your date that you upload. And in order to be able to do that beforehand, you need to define a type which makes up this FAIR Digital Object. So currently we have like four types available in our data lake: raw data, process data, container, and the job manifest. And then users can, from user space, really derive from these data types and then define by this their own ones by providing the necessary metadata, which would describe in a semantic way their object that they are building with their data. And around each of these objects has operations associated with it. These operations now cannot be defined by users. They are given by the types they derived from. And the nice thing is now that users don't need to interact first with the database, then with the storage system, then they compute something. They just call the operations which are defined on their digital object. And then the interactions with the backend services is orchestrated by the data lake. And by this, we can guarantee this consistent state. And we can also enforce this unified governance across these different services, which we include in our system. You know, if you want to think about how can you build such a conceptual idea in the real world, the only really practical way we could come up with is by putting a data lake layer, built based on a web application in front of our backend services, so in front of our database, on our storage system, our HPC system here, and users are then only interacting with this data lake layer where these digital objects in a conceptual way then exist, and only see this level, and based on these operations and the other things, the data lake is then working with the database and so on. As an example, how would that look like in practice? So let's assume we want to ingest some data. First of all, we need to define our digital object. So for instance, we could say we want to define a Christmas present. So what semantic information would describe a Christmas present? I suggest, for instance, the recipient, the address where it should be delivered, the content very important, and maybe the date of delivery. So is it on Christmas Eve or the day after? And by whom was it delivered? So in Germany, it's usually Santa Claus, but I believe in Sweden, it's a goblin, or how it's called in English. And so there are different ideas in different countries what is used. And if we would now want to upload a date, and which should then become a Christmas present in our data lake, we upload our date. So here it's now a toy car, and in my real world use cases would be an MR image. And then the data lake mounts the state into a user provided container. So this container now is really provided by the user. The image is also maintained usually by the user or by us. And in here we have some software which is able to read in the attributes, the semantic information of the state, and then returns a JSON file with the corresponding attributes. And also by giving the type of this digital object, which is also defined during upload, we then basically get our Christmas present object on this data lake level. This JSON file is then used to index this date in our Elasticsearch cluster, which is the backbone of our data catalog. And the date itself is saved unchanged in our Ceph cluster. So we're really retaining our raw data. And these functions of these digital objects, these are again only available on this data lake application, on this layer where the user interacts with. So for instance, this unpack Christmas present function can only be called here, and the data lake would know what to do, and of course would then send the corresponding requests to Elasticsearch, to Ceph, or whatever is involved in here. Now coming back a little bit from this Christmas example, more into the data science world. So currently we are really using this for data science applications, and what is done here is that users still write and maintain their code as they always did. So they are writing their code, they are pushing it to GitLab, they are running their CI/CD pipelines, and when they are satisfied with their code and they want to run it on our HPC system, they write locally on their working stations, they write a so-called job manifest. This job manifest unambiguously describes what job they want to run on the HPC system. So what Git repository should be used, what branch, what commit, what environment should be used, what input data which we have ingested before in the Ceph cluster should be used, and so on. And based on this job manifest, the data lake can then create all the necessary scripts to perform this task, and then also fetch the data from the Ceph cluster and stage it into our parallel file system, which is directly in the fabric of our HPC system, so it's very fast. And then after the environment is prepared, so after the Git repository is cloned, built, and everything is done, starts the job remotely for the user automatically. And when it's done, the defined artifacts are uploaded again and can then be re-ingested so that they are also available in this data catalog. Because this job manifest really 100% basically describes this transformation, we don't need runtime auditing to catch the provenance. It's enough really if we save this job manifest, and then we can link the input data with this job manifest to the output data, and with this we can then build such a provenance-centered graph along in our data lake. And if then a user is interested, how did I get this output value? How did I create this final data product that I would like to publish somewhere? This can be easily packaged because we just need to do this graph traversal here and just fetch everything that somehow is connected to this workflow, and then we are done. This job manifest is maybe a little bit difficult to write for unexperienced users, but we are working on such a Python SDK to make it a little bit easier to interact with it. So you just, within this structured manner here, you just define your job where you have these different options you can choose from. And this is all done locally on your machine. So for instance, on your laptop, you then just perform this job submit function, and then a job on the HPC system will start at some point. You can also monitor the status of your jobs and print whatever attributes you are interested in. So for instance, the Git commits, the repositories used, whatever you like. So in conclusion, I personally believe that building a data lake, first of all, of course, is possible with open source software, but one should be wary that this does not yield a patchwork of different systems with different software stacks, with different access controllers, because in the end, this all needs to be maintained. And you, depending on the data, of course, you may even be required by law to guarantee the correctness and the consistency of your data. And there, a highly complex system is very counterproductive. And to solve this issue, I presented to you a novel data lake architecture, which is based on FAIR Digital Objects. This is specifically designed for scientific applications because we made it reproducible by design and also portable and configurable in self-service. And this entire idea of having, for instance, these job manifests, which also can be easily exchanged, hopefully fosters the collaborations of the involved researchers. And because we did not make any use case assumptions here today, we are just building our digital objects. We hope that this maximizes the reusability of our data sets. And because we have this data lake layer in between, if something happens, we can easily just switch so from Elasticsearch to OpenSearch or something different. And because the user only call these functions which are defined on this data lake layer, this is very easily possible for us in the background to do this. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attentions and are there any questions?
Hendrik, thank you very much for your talk. Fascinating. It's not you work in an area that's so different from my day-to-day. I love these talks where I learn about a world that I don't know anything about. So we have Hendrik with us. Any questions for Hendrik?
Hi, Hendrik. Yes, very, very good talk. Thank you. This was very close to our hearts when I was working at genomics in Oxford, and particularly the providence of data is a very important thing. Being able to prove that your data is the data you're talking about, particularly when data sets change quite a bit. Could you tell us a little bit more about sort of providence in your architecture and
Of course. So first of all, provenance is basically recorded at two different places. So first in the ingestion phase, there of course we can record, so for instance from which MR scanner came the date, if this date is available and important. This can be done. And the probably more important provenance that we record is on this processing level. And here is the idea that we don't need to have really this this runtime provenance auditing in place, because we define everything in our job manifest. And then we are just linking in our Elasticsearch cluster currently, so in our database, in our data catalog, when we create here some artifact as a result of our transformation, we store it back in our data lakes, and then we put the information of this job manifest, how it was created, in the provenance attributes. And then we can link basically in a graph here the input data, the job, and the output data. And because all of these parts, so for instance, the computations are performed in Singularity containers on our HPC system, and we store in this data lake the images of our containers, we could then just resend this job manifest, and the entire job would be re-executed. So we can always reproduce a result.